And the folds were filled with their flesh. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, begins a new vision that the Lord Jesus gave to the Apostle John. Here John saw the Lord Jesus Christ come out of heaven, riding on a white horse, and all the armies which were in heaven followed him on white horses. We need to keep in mind that this vision is recorded in highly symbolic terms. We must learn to understand parabolic statements in the Bible, which we can understand by comparing scripture with scripture. The main point of this passage recorded in verse 11, verse 16 is, the king is coming with all his saints. Revelation 19, verse 11, and following verses. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his side a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Lord Jesus Christ comes out of heaven as a leader of an army that goes to fight the nations of the world at the Battle of Armageddon. He rides on a horse to indicate that he comes to fight the war. He is clothed with a vesture dipped in blood to indicate that he has finished one battle already. It was the battle at the cross where he fought for us, rebellious sinners, but elect of God. In our blood has stained his vesture. And when he comes again, he shall bring all the souls of all the saints with him, as we have read in 1 Thessalonians 3, verse 13, and 4, verse 14. And God will raise up the bodies of all those who have died, some to everlasting life, and some to the shame, to shame and everlasting contempt. There are many verses in the Bible that refer to this event of Christ coming with all the saints. These are the armies that symbolically follow Christ on white horses. For example, as we read in Jude 14, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. We read in Zechariah 14, verse 5, And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee. And then he will rapture all his saints. The people that are left on earth are the nations that shall be judged. They shall be judged by a sharp sword out of the mouth of Christ. The Lord Jesus said in John 12, verse 48, "The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." Dus we can understand the symbolism of the two-edged sword out of his mouth, that with it he should smite the nations. And then Christ shall break them with a rod of iron, and shall pour his wrath upon them while they are in the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Then shall all the heathen know that he always has been the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The exact wording of verse 16 in the Greek text is as follows. "And he has on his vesture and on his tide a name have been written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." In other words, in a prior action, his name has already been written this way. That means that today Christ is already King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He has had this title ever since he victoriously rose from the grave. For this is what he said in Matthew 28, verse 18. Then we read that he calls it a call to the fowls of the air. Revelation 19, verse 17 and following verses. "And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of the air of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that ye may eat flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth. And all the fowls were filled with their flesh." These seven words are the title of this article. All the fowls were filled with their flesh. We are going to see what it means that the Lord Jesus Christ in verse 19 calls for the fowls to eat the flesh of the armies that are gathered together to make war against Christ. Yes, it is Lord Jesus, who calls this angel standing in the sun. Is God's way to symbolize the brightness of Christ's coming. in Revelation 1, the Lord Jesus shows himself to John in symbolic terms. We cannot draw a picture of this scene. We must understand the words. Revelation 1 verse 16. And he had in his hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shining in his strength. Not only his face is shining as the sun, his entire being is shining as the sun. We can see this in the prophecy of Malachi. Here in Malachi 4, God speaks about the judgment day. Both the second judgment day, the last day, and the first judgment day at the cross. In Malachi 4, Malachi 4, verse 1, God speaks about the last day. We read there, "For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, said the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and ye shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall." You that fear my name refers to the saints. For the saints, the coming of Christ will not be a burning like an oven. For the saints, Christ shall come as the Son of Righteousness with healing in his wings. For the saints, Christ shall appear as the sun in the and the rays of this sun shall bring healing to their dead bodies, and shall rise them up with glorified bodies that will be raptured up to be with Christ forever. Who are these players on the scene? We see the Lord Jesus Christ. We see all the saints and angels. They are the armies that follow Christ. We see the unsaved people of the world, including the beast and the false prophet, for these are also people in service of Satan. But whereas the symbols of Satan in his fallen, where are the symbols of Satan in his fallen angels? Could it be that the false that fly in mid heaven are the symbols of Satan and his angels? Let us search this out. The falls that fly in mid heaven. In the Old Testament, the complete defeat of an army is symbolized not by burning the bodies of the slain, to give their flesh to the birds of heaven for meat is an expressive of the most complete and shameful defeat possible. These birds of heaven are vultures that feed on dead rotting flesh. However, God does not invent metaphors arbitrarily. These vultures feeding on dead people have a deeper spiritual meaning, which we can find in the New Testament in three of the narrative Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The fowls of the air usually represent the devil in his angels. You find this in Matthew 13 verse 4. In Matthew 30 verse 32. And in Mark 4 verse 4. In Mark 4 verse 32. And in Luke 8 verse 5. And Luke 13 verse 19. This is the spiritual meaning of the folds we find in most of the New Testament. Is it possible that this is also the meaning of the folds of Revelation 19, verse 17? Let us first establish these folds fly. In Revelation 19, verse 17, Christ is taking to the folds that fly in the midst of heaven. Actually, these last four words are in the Greek text only one word, meaning midst, mid-heaven. Where is mid-heaven? Is mid-heaven the third heaven where God and his angels dwell? No way. It is the firmament where the sun and the moon and the stars are? Absolutely not. Therefore, this mid-heaven must refer to the sky, where the birds fly. They would not be able to fly in outer space, for there is no air there where they can flap their wings. We read in Genesis 1, verse 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. The Hebrew word for heaven is here a plural word. Heavens indicated that God created more than one heaven. For he created also the heaven of heavens, or the invisible third heaven, where God and his angels dwell. But there is no other heaven. Please drop down to verse 14, where we read, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And if you drop down to verse 20, you see another heaven where the folds of the air fly. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that has life, and the fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. That God meant the word heaven to be understood in the plural sense is demonstrated in Genesis 2 verse 1. There we read, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. No wonder that the Apostle Paul specified that he was caught up in the third heaven, where God and the angels dwell, in 2 Corinthians 12 verse 2. And thus we see that the folds that fly in mid-heaven refers to the sky above. God gave us here an interesting chapter, which I have titled, A Picture of Hell. Revelation 19 verse 1 to 8 refers to the end of the world, where all the nations and all their armies are destroyed for their rebellion against God. In addition, all the unsaved nations are symbolized by the land of Iduma, or Edom, of the land of Esau. Remember, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Romans 9 verse 13. All the unsaved of the world are represented by Esau. And where do all these slain unsaved people end up? They end up in hell, which is exactly the description of the second half of this chapter. Interestingly, God fills this horrible hell with all kinds of wild beasts. The first half of Isaiah 34 concerns people. The enemies of God are killed and cast into this place that resembles hell. But the second half of this chapter speaks only about wild beasts and wild fowls of the air. We read in Isaiah 34, verse 9, "And the streams thereof shall be turned into pitch, and the dust thereof into brimstone, and the land thereof shall become burning pits. It shall not be cleansed night nor day. The smoke thereof shall go up forever, from generation to generation. It shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever." "But the cormorant and the bittern shall possess it. The owl also and the raven shall dwell in it. And he shall stretch out upon it the line of confusion and the stones of emptiness. They shall call the nobles thereof to the kingdom, but none shall be there, and all her princes shall be nothing. And all the thorns shall come up in her places, palaces, nettles and brambles in the fortresses thereof, and it shall be an habitation of dragons or serpents, in a court for owls. The wild beast of the desert shall also meet with the wild beast of the island, and the satyr that shall cry to his fellow, to screech owl also there, also shall rest there, and find for herself a place of rest." "There shall be a great owl make her nest, and lay, and hatch, and gather under her shadow. There shall be the vultures also be gathered, every one with her mate. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord, and read. No one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate, for my mouth has commanded, and his spirit in it has, and his spirit it has gathered them, and he has cast a lot for them, and his hand he divided it in unto them by line. They shall possess it forever, from generation to generation shall they dwell therein." In verse 9, brimstone and burning pits are typifying hell. Moreover, verse 10 says, "The smoke thereof shall go up forever." And we know for certain that it refers to hell. We know that this earth will be destroyed, and thus for this land, bearing of the curse of God, to burn forever. It must be a symbol of hell. Interestingly, most of the wild beasts of this land are unclean predators or are vultures, all meat-eating birds of the kind that the Lord Jesus is calling in Revelation 19, verse 17. Who do these wild animals and fowls represent here in Isaiah 34? God says in verse 17 that the wild bird shall possess the land forever. Moreover, in verse 14, we shall read, the satyr shall cry there. Is here a connection with satyrs and demons? The Hebrew word for satyr is a word that most often has been translated goat. This description of a satyr in Isaiah 34 is anticipating the role of the goats in the parable of the sheep and the goats that the Lord Jesus told us in Matthew 25. Sometimes that Hebrew word cannot be simply translated as goat, since the context indicates that this animal has ominous connotations. Ominous means it is foreboding or foreshadowing evil. Therefore, two times we find that this word has been translated devils, and two times it has been translated satyr. Now let's look at Leviticus 17, verse 7. There we read, and they shall no more offer their sacrifices unto devils, after whom they have gone whoring. This shall be a statute forever unto them throughout their generations. Likewise, we read of the sin of Jeroboam, who made Israel to sin. Jeroboam, who made Israel to sin, in 2 Chronicles 11, verse 15. And he ordered him priest for the high places, and for the devils, and for the calves which he had made. Moreover, God speaks about Babylon in Isaiah 13, as if it shall reflect the land described in Isaiah 34. Isaiah 13, verse 20 says, it shall be never be inhabited, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation unto generation, neither shall the Arabian prince tent there, neither shall the shepherds make their fold there. But the wild beast of the desert shall lie there, and their houses shall be full of doleful creatures, and olds shall dwell there, and satyrs shall dance there. Instead of forever, the Lord uses the expression from generation to generation. Babylon as a wasteland shall be dwelt in from generation to generations. Satyrs shall dwell there. Of course, satyrs do not really exist. They are a figure out of the Greek mythology. But the King James translators use this word to indicate the ominous connotations attached to this creature here in Isaiah 13, verse 21, and in Isaiah 34, verse 40. And so we see that the second half of Isaiah 34 underscores that this chapter is speaking about hell. But since satyrs and wild fowls do not represent people in hell, who could they represent? The only answer to this question is that they represent demons, namely Satan and his fallen angels. This is a terrifying conclusion, but it is the only one I know of that harmonizes with everything else. In Ezekiel 39, God speaks about end time events, where Satan is going to invade the mountains of Israel, and people from the premillennial persuasion grab the events of this chapter as evidence that fierce literal battle is going to take place there east of the Mediterranean. They fail to realize that the ground is level and the food at the foot of the cross. Galatians 3 verse 28 says, there is neither Jew nor Greek. We are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Galatians 6 verse 16, we are the Israel of God. In Galatians 4 verse 25, Israel, which now is in bondage with their children. They do not take it into account. Philippians 3 verse 3 says, we are the circumcision. And Romans 2 verse 29 says, he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart. And so on. And so, we look at Ezekiel 39, we must understand that God is speaking symbolically. During the final tribulation period, Satan is going to invade the churches throughout the world. And the result will be that the church becomes the harlot church called Babylon. This is the invasion of Satan on the mountains of Israel. In addition, Satan will instigate the nations of the world to oppose God in Christ. And thus, when Christ comes for the second time, there will be a great slaughter of all the unsaved who are in rebellion against God. And then we read in Ezekiel 39 verse 17, and thou son of man, thus said the Lord God, speak unto every feathered fowl and to every beast on the field, assemble yourself and come, gather yourselves on every side to sacrifice, that I do sacrifice for you. Even a great sacrifice upon the mountains of Israel, that ye may eat flesh and drink blood. Ye shall eat the flesh of the mighty and drink the blood of princes of the earth, of rams, of lambs, and goats, and bullocks, all of them fatlings of Bashan. And ye shall eat fit till ye be full, and drink blood till ye be drunken of my sacrifice, which I have sacrificed for you. Thus ye shall be filled at my table with horses and chariots, with mighty men, all, and with all men of war, said the Lord God. Here in Ezekiel 39, it is not only the fowls of the air, but also the beasts of the field who are partaking of the dead bodies. These are the beasts and the fowls that we have seen in Isaiah 34, which is a picture of hell. This is the same event that we have seen in Revelation 19, verse 17 till 21. For God uses the same terms of his wrath in both these passages. The fowls of the air and the beasts of the fields eat the carcasses of those that have been slain with the word, with the sword. And thus we see that the wild fowls and the wild beasts of Isaiah 34 and Isaiah and Ezekiel 39 and Revelation 19 all represent demons which are invited to eat of the unsaved that are cast into hell. Can this be true? All people. Are people dead when this happened? And now we remember, dust shall be the serpent's meat. In Isaiah 65, God speaks of the events on the last day, and God speaks of two groups of people and two different actions he is going to take to reward those two groups of people. To the unsaved, he brings to their remembrance their sins. And God says in verse 12, Isaiah 65, verse 12, therefore I will number you with the sword. To those who are saved, he will bring to their remembrance in verse 9 that their salvation is entirely by grace, and God says in Isaiah 65, verse 9. I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob and out of Judah, an inheritor of my mountains. Now we turn to verse 25, and God sums up the condition in the new heavens and a new world, in the conditions in hell. God says in Isaiah 65, verse 25, and the wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the bullock, and dust shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt or destroy in my holy mount, all my holy mountain, said the Lord. What is this? Shall the serpent, representing Satan, eat dust? Is this his punishment? We know that this is much too lenient penalty for Satan. God is speaking in parables again. When we think of dust shall be the serpent's meat, we are reminded of another occasion when God said that the serpent shall eat dust. Let me read you from Genesis 3, verse 14, where God spoke to the serpent that indwelt in the serpent indwelled by Satan, who had just successfully attempted Adam and Eve to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Genesis 3, verse 14. And the Lord said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. All the days of thy life. Now we understand that God was not speaking to a snake, but to Satan. For we know that the snake is carnivorous. No snake on earth eats dust ever. But does Satan eat dust? Let us look 5 verses down in Genesis 3 verse 19, where God says to Adam, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. And thus when we read of Satan eating dust, we should think of him eating people. Does God more often refer to Satan eating people? Yes, of course. God says in 1 Peter 5 verse 8, be sober, be vigilant, because of your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walketh he about, seeking whom he may devour. When the devil devours people in this life, it means that he has persuaded those people to abandon the true God in Christ and either to worship a false God or to live carefree life in the total absence of God. Either way, they are totally in the hands of Satan. Their doom is sure. But what does it mean when In the life hereafter in hell, God says, dust shall be the serpent's meat. Satan and his demons shall delight themselves in torturing those who together with him are suffering in hell. Their doom is sure, and Satan and his demons shall make sure that the suffering of the unsaved people in hell knows no end. Even though Satan and his demons are tortured themselves, he shall delight to bring additional affliction on people he hates most. Whom does Satan hate most? God gives him the desire to hate those whom God intends to deserve the deepest place in hell. For Satan is God's busiest servant in this life, and he will still be God's busiest servant in the life hereafter. Whom does God hate most? God hates religious people who pretend to serve him, but instead are serving other gods. The nation of Israel, before their Babylonian captivity, was one of the nations whom God hated most, for they were busy serving other gods. That is why we read four times in the prophecy of Jeremiah, in the carcasses of this people shall be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beast of the earth. And we read in Jeremiah 3 verse 33 the same, and in Jeremiah 14 verse 4, and Jeremiah 19 verse 7, and in Jeremiah 34 verse 20. Does this not remind you of Isaiah 34, where these fowls of heaven and the beast of the earth are representing the demons in hell? Does this not remind you of Revelation 19, verse 17 and 18? We return now to Revelation 19, where the Lord Jesus Christ calls on the fowls that fly in mid-heaven, come to the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. Indeed, rattlesnakes come in all sizes, both small and great. Unsaved people come in all sizes, both small and great. Then we read in Revelation 19, verse 19, and I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And then follows what is often called the Battle of Armageddon. Perhaps you remember how we got to this stage in history. Revelation 16, verse 13 till 16. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of his mouth, and of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and to the whole world, to gather them to battle of the great day of God Almighty. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked, and they see his shame. And he gathered them together in a place called, in the Hebrew tongue, Armageddon. And then we read in Revelation 19, verse 19, that armies are gathered together. Is there going to be a literal army with cannons and planes that intend to go battle against God and Christ? Can we indeed expect that all the nations of the earth under Antichrist shall be assembled here for the purpose of fighting against Christ when he comes again from heaven in his final appearance in glory? That is ridiculous. First of all, it is against the word of God. First of all, it is against the word of God to believe that all the world shall expect the coming of Christ, and certainly that all the people of the world shall be bold enough to strike at Christ or assemble for the battle against Christ is contrary to the scriptures. In fact, the world does not believe in the coming of Jesus. That is what the Bible teaches, and that is what we see in the world today. Secondly, there is nothing from which the world weans away faster and faster than from the idea of the second coming of Christ. Thirdly, it is simply absurd to suppose that even if they expect the coming of Christ, they would have the courage to gather their armies in order to fight against him. No, instead they will be filled with fear, for they know that Christ cometh with all his angels, and one angel is more powerful than all the airplanes and cannons in the earth. How then do we understand the battle of Armageddon to be? First of all, we must remember that these words in the prophecy of Revelation are written symbolically. We must search out what these symbols mean by comparing scripture with scripture. Secondly, we must harmonize end events with the statements by the Lord Jesus Christ, such as those that we read in Matthew 24, 37-39. In Luke 17, verse 26 till 30, we read Matthew 24, verse 37. But as in the days of Noah were, so shall also be the coming of the Son of Man be. For in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving to marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came, and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, and they drank, and they married wives, and they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. And destroyed them all. Likewise also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, and they drank, and they bought, and they sold, and they planted, and they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven, and destroyed them all. And thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. In other words, no one shall expect Jesus coming. It will be business as usual. There will be no great bloodletting on earth, like a worldwide persecution. There will be no nuclear war, or another great world war, or a great calamity by terrorists. There will be no great famine or starvation of Christians, because they do not have the mark of the beast on their forehead. None of these things shall be in place. But what there will be in place is a great apostasy, so great that we fear none of our children will be saved if this apostasy continues for 70 years. This, in fact, is the character of the great tribulation that we will have to endure. The character of the final tribulation period is typified by the statement of the Lord Jesus in Matthew 24, verse 24, where he says, For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall shew great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. This is the nature of the final tribulation period. And this is the attitude of all the nations of the world against Christ. And this is how they are fighting against Christ, not with a physical armor or bullets or bombs, but with contempt for Christ and with contempt for the Bible and with scorn and ridicule of those who are still holding on to the old-time religion and with false gospels that are designed to deceive. If possible, even the elect, and with ways to put extreme pressure on those who do not want to convert to the charismatic gospel. Therefore, God warns us for this dangerous period of time, for it is so easy to collapse. Here is a serious warning from God. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had a dream in which he saw a great statue, of which Daniel told him that this statue represents all the kingdom on this earth, beginning with the king Nebuchadnezzar as the head of gold. But then we read in Daniel 2 verse 44, "And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." Let us read this carefully. God said, "It shall never be destroyed, and a new kingdom shall not be left to other people, and it shall consume all the kingdoms of this earth, and it shall stand forever." Can this be accomplished in a New Testament era? No. This will only be accomplished if this earth shall be destroyed and a new heaven and new earth shall be ushered in. Only then shall all these kingdoms on this earth be destroyed, and only then shall the new kingdom not be left in the hands of other people. And so Daniel 2 verse 44 speaks of the end of the world when Christ shall come and all the saints with them. For the saints it will be a glorious day, full of excitement and glory. But for the unsaved it will be a horrifying day. Just think of it. The most terrifying horror movie would be insufficient to describe the horror standing at a judgment throne. Standing before the judgment throne of Christ, all the people wait in line, and all will have a plain view of the lake of fire. No one will have an excuse or a defense before Christ. Everyone standing at the judgment throne before have been picked up by the angels and dropped into the lake of fire. And who is waiting there? Satan and all the demons, which are tormented in the lake of fire, And they are blaming the entire human race for getting them into this nasty situation, symbolically speaking. All the falls of the air are ready to attack our precious body. All the beauty faces, all the beautiful faces that have been well kept for so many years shall be torn by those birds and shall be scorned by the flames. And there is no one to help, for the day of salvation has passed. Such is a warning of Almighty God to listen to his word of the Bible. Amen.